everybody out there. I'm Stick Nixon. That's Pat sitting across from me. That's Mike Spike. Over there. You're Spike now. That's Spike. Spike sitting to my left. You're listening to Rock Underfire, the number one rock and roll podcast going in the nation. The boys, for once, allowed me to start off the show. It's so hard to get a word in edgewise once these guys start going, man.
Come
so I just
want
to say a few things really quickly off the bat. Lay the groundwork for what's going to be a very interesting show. Don't cry. Put your head on our shoulders. We're going to talk about 1966 a little bit later in the show. But I want to introduce what might be a new segment of ours. We call it What's Going On. Rather than jumping right into the topic at hand, let's take a few minutes in the beginning of the show just to talk about random things related to rock and roll music. Maybe you spun a record you haven't heard in a long time and you loved it. Maybe you went to a concert. You want to address something that happened in a past show, something you said, any number of things related to rock and roll music, fellas, we can talk about in the new opening segment. We agreed on this, right? Called What's Going On?
You will
typically hear the Marvin Gaye version of him saying what's going on. We'll leave an empty space for that.
You got to hum it in your head, though. We don't have the rights
to
play that.
I have to edit it in.
Or I can do it.
I think I could squeeze in like 10 seconds.
We can both make
we can, you know, hey, man, we could use the publicity.
Yeah,
I don't care. We could use a lawsuit here
what's
and there.
Yeah, we don't need a lawsuit.
I can afford a lawsuit.
What's going on, everybody,
what's
man?
What's going on, boys?
It's been a long...
That's all I want.
It's been a couple of weeks.
Been a couple weeks, no air conditioning. We had an air conditioner glitch here at Rock Under Fire Studios. If Pat gets too hot, his candy coating melts off. So for his safety, man, we didn't do the show. But we're back. And a few things have happened since we've been gone. Some band called Led Zeppelin tried to steal Spirit songs. What the heck? What else is going on, fellas?
I don't know. It's hot. It's New Jersey. It's the summer.
You don't want to talk about the concert that we all went to?
Yeah, Steely Dan. I mean, that was a home run. Steve Winwood, I thought, was spectacular. I didn't expect him to be as good as he was, and he played all his old stuff. I thought that was fantastic.
I was running into the venue during Steve Winwood's final song. I must admit, I missed it totally. And technically, I've still never seen Steve Winwood live, I guess. Have I ever seen him live?
That was my first time. I was glad he did some traffic. It was pretty traffic-heavy set.
Awesome.
Some Blind Faith at the end. And what else did he do? And then he kind of went into his 80s solo period, which surprisingly got a very big reception.
It played well.
I was calling. Now, I said at the end, I was like, nobody wants to hear him doing Higher Love.
Right.
Back in the High Life and all that stuff. But you know what? I was wrong. The whole place, you know what? They were actually more, the crowd was more rowdy for Steve Winwood than they were for Steely Dan. I was surprised. I think it was maybe just the fact that it was like 106 degrees.
Yes.
Yeah. It was hot, man.
It was just bad.
Did he do Roll With It? That tune I do like.
I don't think he did Roll With It.
No. Can't Find My Way Home, I thought, was probably the best, one of the best songs of the night. He killed that, man. He really did. And then obviously, you know, Steely Dan is Steely Dan. You're either a fan of that band or you're not. I've said it on this show a million times. Hey, you know, I dig that band a lot.
All three of us rarely agree about anything.
One of those artists that you know, you either love or hate. There's no in between with Steely Dan. People are just rabid haters or...
Yeah.
It's Fagan's voice. People don't like Fagan's voice.
That's a good point. You know, it's sometimes, you know, the music is there. It's undeniable how good they are musician-wise. But you're right. That voice, it's either a love-hate relationship. Bruce is the same way.
Isn't that true about every band you don't like, though? You don't like the singer's voice, if you really think about it.
So, I don't know. I mean, maybe we should address, too, some Facebook comments and some you know, people have been asking, when's episode 6?
That's what the What's Going On segment's all about, Pat.
Yeah, man. And you know, believe me, we've been all dying, chomping at the bit to get in here and talk about, you know, like Stick said, tonight's topic is 1966. A lot happened to go on in that year. But I just wanted to touch on some Facebook stuff. I know, Mike D, you want to talk about some stuff, some comments. And
I want to thank Aaron Novak, and I want to give his radio show a special shout-out. It's called Memphis, Egypt with Aaron and Todd, and it's WDCE 90.1 FM in Richmond, Virginia. Online, WDCE.org. You can find them also on Podbean, and they're a very eclectic blend of old and new, rare and obscure. Aaron is slowly restoring my faith that good stuff still exists out there in terms of new music. And he gave us a very, he gave us a special shout out on his show. He does the show on Tuesday nights from 9 to 11. And again, it's a weekly show. I think if you like what we're doing, or even if you don't like what we're doing, you know, these guys have their own thing going. It's music based. It's not very, you know, there's a lot of commentary in between songs, but for the most part, it's just a lot of really, really good music.
You know what it reminds me of? Locally, there's a station here, 105.5 DHA. And on Sunday mornings, Jim Monahan, you might remember him from NEW days, he does a show All Mixed Up. And Aaron's show kind of reminds me of that because they play music that maybe you haven't heard in a while. They'll play a really deep cut. I mean, some really good deep tracks. Oh, absolutely. And then they talk in between, you know, he'll talk in between some of the stuff and give you an idea of a vibe for that song. And I liked it a lot. Not only because of the kind words. I mean, he had some really good things to say about us. And again, much appreciated to Aaron big time. He went into like... talking about the Zeppelin song that he played and how it might be it was the Rain song, right?
Yeah.
It might be the perfect Led Zeppelin song.
There's nothing you could do to make it any better.
Yeah, and it got me thinking. I was like, wow, man, he really...
But that's Led Zeppelin for you. That is Led Zeppelin for you. There's not much room for improvement because
mainstream media loves to jump on the Stairway to Heaven bandwagon and everything. But he touched on a nerve with me. I was like, wow. I listened to his song again. And I was like, hey, he really did. He hit on something.
So what else do we have? Do you have anything else you want to say before we get into what we're talking about this week or what?
Yeah, sure. I want to address something that was in a past episode, actually. Pat, Mike reminded me that this thing we're doing goes over something called the Internet, also known as the World Wide Web. You know, and like a net or a web, it can reach people all across the globe, in the four corners of the globe, apparently. You know, so you got to be careful what you say. Don't be uncool to those who matter to you. I'm coming clean in a past episode. I didn't expect my parents to be fans of the show, to listen to the show, but I think one of the first things that I said, I think I suggested that my parents were clueless about all the cool music that was out during their time in the 60s and 70s. I lamented that they weren't part of some counterculture, you know. I changed my mind totally about that. Glad for my... middle class upbringing, my hot dog and hamburger, red, white, and blue American upbringing all the way. I'm glad you got me Star Wars figures and not a didgeridoo. I'm glad you sent me to school.
I want to see you play a didgeridoo.
I think he has one, or he had one.
Your ex-girlfriend stole my didgeridoo.
Mr. and Mrs. Nixon. Stick needs a didgeridoo.
Yeah, you know,
they came down on you for stuff that you said in that first.
They didn't come down on me at all, but I know they listened. So I was like,
it's still cool. I mean, hey, you know, my mother listened to it. What about you, Mike? Did your mom listen to it?
They've listened to a few shows. Yeah,
that's cool.
Yeah.
My daughter's listened to it. I'm okay with her listening to it. You know, the language sometimes might be a little salty, but we're not really going, you know, we're not talking about anything out of line.
I told my mother that we're on iTunes now. She was like, oh, that's nice. I don't think she really understands what iTunes is. That's another thing. We are on iTunes now. So besides finding us on through our Facebook page and YouTube. You can find us on iTunes, so we could use your support.
We graduated.
Write a review. Hey, you know what?
Hey,
write a review.
If you can do iTunes, you have the podcast app on your iPhone or whatever it is that you use, we would appreciate your support on iTunes. You know, go there. We would love for you to subscribe, download the show, and even review it.
We just did a little, on Facebook. We did some live video of the beginning of the show.
Just to tantalize you.
Show everybody what we got coming out. It was a cool way to get everybody interested, I think. We're gonna try and do a lot more stuff like that going forward, just to get a nice internet audience going.
Mm-hmm.
Stick, you know, I know he's afraid of the internet. He hasn't warmed up to the internet quite yet.
Nets are dangerous. See what these things do to fish, turtles, and sea life. You get stuck in those things. So thanks, Dad, for being a toolmaker. Ma, for being a hairdresser and not being part of an avant-garde theater group. I got like a dozen of these. I'll stop at that one. But I got a lot I can say for the what's going on segment.
What's going on?
Save
so
them.
Tell
I'll
us.
Save them for other show. I got so much to say.
I don't know about much going on.
Little at a time.
You know, I've been listening to a lot of Talking Heads this week, the past 2 weeks, probably all summer. So that's all I have to say about that.
Talking Heads.
Talking
Heads.
I have a my what's going on is another shout out to Brandon. It's a guy I work with. He wrote a really nice review on iTunes, and I just I totally dig it. It's kind of, you know, when this thing all came to fruition with the three of us, we kind of envisioned sitting around in a bar just talking about music and having somebody overhear that conversation and say, wow, those guys kind of know what they're talking about. They're interesting, sometimes a little eccentric. We all are, absolutely. But Brandon in particular, he said that he's learned a few cool nuggets from it.
I hope so.
And I, you know, I that's so. What that's what we're doing it for. You might not, and you don't have to agree with
for
what
didactic reasons.
You don't have, and they love Stick. They love Stick. Stick, you're a rock star, dude.
Should I turn that
down? Very academic element to rock and roll that a lot of podcasts don't touch on. So if anybody learns a damn thing from us, that's a great thing.
Absolutely.
And Brandon, we appreciate your comments.
You too, Dominic.
And so, also out there in the listening audience, you might want to know that we're doing this show sober tonight. No one brought beer. No one brought a damn beer. I'm drinking iced tea.
I got water.
Nothing.
That could be good. I'm for myself included. I heard playback of one of them was like, oh, yeah, yeah.
You won't have to poke me.
I don't know, man. Mike, I think it's on you now. Let's just roll right into this.
Roll with it, baby.
It was a good. You know, I did a little research that, like Stick said in the beginning, that the topic is 1966. So I had to kind of go back and pull some things up. But
I've been telling people about 1966. Anybody that's asked about the next topic, and I'm saying, yeah, we're doing a show on 1966. And every once in a while, I guess every fifth or sixth show, we're going to be doing a special edition episode where we focus on one band or one artist or one topic. And we were talking about, you know, in kind of behind the scenes, and I'll give Tracy a shout out because she's been very supportive. And Tracy is, she kind of works behind the scenes, and she does a lot of our social media.
Yeah.
She does a lot of our Facebook page. And we just kind of consult her. Hey, what do you think of this? What do you think of that? And she's going to be on our Beatles episode coming up. So we're kind of talking about the Beatles episode, putting that together. And we were talking about some comments that we had a discussion about the Beach Boys a while back. This is going back maybe 2 months now, and we were just saying, well, you know, what could we do? How could we frame the Beatles episode? We could get into it with the fact that it's going to be the 50th anniversary of Revolver in August. And then we started talking, well, maybe we should do a show on the Beach Boys and, you know, talk about Pet Sounds because it's the 50th anniversary of Pet Sounds, too. It's like, why don't we just acknowledge Blonde on Blonde? Why don't we just do a whole show on 1966?
I remember that conversation.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
the Beach Boys came up and I almost vomited.
Yeah.
I got a puke bag for you, don't worry. But now, when Mike first mentioned 1966, my first thought was, that's lovely, but why do 66 when the following year, 1967, was so much kind of more important, arguably the most important year?
Well, that's why we're doing this show, right? Because we're going to, I'm challenging that. I'm challenging that whole
that
idea.
Notion. Yeah.
Now, I don't know if there's going to be a right or wrong answer or who's going to agree or disagree, but it's just information that just exists. Mm-hmm. It's just,
hey,
it's
man.
Just we're dealing with a set of facts of rock and roll history, and I'm putting it up against this notion that 1967 was the year where everything changed.
Summer of Love, people, don't forget that.
You could not have got to 1967 without going through 66 first. Now that's obvious.
Tremendous.
On the surface, you know, you can't get any more obvious than that. But going through the music and just assessing the music that we're going to talk about tonight, I think we can make a pretty good case is that for 1966 being that dividing line.
A lot of stuff happened in that year. As I started researching it,
well,
I was blown away by some of the things that happened in that year. I'm nowhere near the numbers guys, that you guys are. There's no doubt. I mean, I can talk the talk.
What do you mean numbers? You mean
him especially. Well, he can 1966. This. It was August and it was August 5th. And I was like, what?
Sometimes it's called superior autobiographical memory. And there's like 30 or 40 people in this world that are diagnosed with it, that exist, where they can repeat and they can recite. Every
you can say
day
that
of
shit all
life.
You want. Somebody plugged him in and just downloaded it right into him.
Mike can tell you what he was doing.
I don't know. The actress
from Taxi.
It's impressive, man.
Yeah. The girl from Taxi.
That's
remember
right.
that show, Taxi?
She was on Howard.
She's one of those people. And
she was on Howard talking about it.
I'm one of those people also. So, but anyway, in the last couple of years, you'll notice, starting with 2014, starting around February of 2014, when they started acknowledging, hey, this is the 50th anniversary of the arrival of the Beatles in the States, and then the Beatles on Ed Sullivan, and then it was 2015, and the 50th anniversary of, all, you know, Dylan going electric and getting booed at Newport Folk Festival, and then the Beatles at Shea Stadium, and the you know, the thing is that when rock and roll became an informative medium, which is a big thing that I like to talk about, where it just completely informed and directed pop culture, starting around 1964, 65, with the arrival of the Beatles, getting into the FM album format, you know, album oriented rock and roll.
Murray the K or Murray the K or
WOR.
Yeah, maybe.
We're coming up against 150th anniversary in a row, and this is going to keep going on for the next 5 years because, you know, next year it's going to be the Summer of Love, and it's going to be Sgt. Pepper. Wait till June. Wait till this time next year. Wait till next summer when everything is Sgt. Pepper. A year from now,
yeah,
it'll be
that's
the
true,
50th
man.
Anniversary of Sgt. Pepper, the
crazy.
Summer of Love, Monterey Pop. You know, 3 years from now, it'll be talking about the 50th anniversary of Woodstock.
That's going to be insane.
So all of these monumental albums in the rock and roll canon we're coming up against. And this time we're going to assess, obviously, 1966, 50 years later. And
we could do 86, 30 years.
Yeah, 30 years from now.
But
1986, we'll be talking about the Beastie Boys, License to Ill.
You guys chill at the White Wedding. We'll be on the Yellow Submarine.
Rick Rubin and the power that he holds over rock and roll and rap.
I also blame Rick Rubin for changing the sound of the Cult, too. So I forgot to mention that in the last show.
He remained true to Slayer, though.
We're digging good vibrations here tonight. Not bad medicine.
Oh, God, good vibrations.
You love
Dr.
You love
Robert,
song, right?
Not Dr. Feelgood.
Yeah, oh, I love the Beach Boys. That's no secret. It's another one of my bands that's a nail on
the chalkboard. I'm not a huge. But I don't think are you a huge Beach Boys lover? I mean, let's make this point. You take away Pet Sounds, then what?
Then they're a single oriented.
Yeah, they have a lot of good songs, but
they're a singles oriented band. But they go back to that early 60s, that period between the Founding Fathers and the arrival of the Beatles, where it's between, like, say, 59 to 63, and it was just nothing but bubblegum pop, and you had the Fabians and the Beach movies and,
weren't the Beach Boys still riding a wave of popularity at the time?
But the Beach Boys were, at the time, you know, it was the first East Coast-West Coast rivalry, and it was the Beach Boys and the Four Seasons. And they were, you know, a lot of fans, a lot of American fans like to cite them as the only two American groups to rival the Beatles. Now, you know, there were the Supremes in there, too. There was Motown. The Supremes were turning out just as many hit songs in 1964 and 65.
Everybody in Britain.
66, you know.
Everybody in Britain was copying what Motown was doing, just toting a rock edge on it.
But the eclectic nature of the charts in 1966, I mean, just the fact that, I mean, look at everything that coexisted. You had the old guard of the Beach Boys and the Four Seasons. You had the even older guard of Dean Martin and Frank Sinatra on the charts. The Supremes, Motown was huge. You had the folk hero of Bob Dylan emerging as a rock star and then quickly disappearing at his motorcycle accident.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
You know, we'll talk about that a little bit. You had the continued evolution of the Beatles and the Rolling Stones, Percy Sledge, garage rock was thriving, the British invasion was still very present on the charts. You had the beginnings of psychedelia, folk rock, soul, R&B, and the Batman theme. And you had Mother's Little Helper coexisting with songs like See You in September. So, I mean, just all kinds of crazy things happening at the same time in 1966.
Something for everybody. Now, Mike, wasn't the Beach Boys, weren't they popular?
Beach Boys were very popular.
I mean, at the time of the British invasion, though. When the Stones and the Beatles are going.
Prior to the British invasion, they were very popular.
Oh, so they're already on the downslide, you think, by the time of the British invasion?
By the time of the counterculture and FM, you know, album-oriented rock, acts like the Beach Boys and the Four Seasons had a lot of trouble
adapting
into that
the
mold.
The Beach Boys were safe. Yeah. They were a safe band.
But in terms of bands...
Brian Wilson had 1 foot in the counterculture and one foot in the past, and I think his bandmates, you know, more like Mike Love was very much against what he was doing.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, with the vocal, you know, with some of the vocal tracks, it's noted that he was not a fan of some of the stuff Wilson was doing.
Yeah,
I, to be honest with you, I hate the Beach Boys. If I hear that, it's probably the worst sound in the world.
You don't like the Good Vibration song?
Nothing. I'd rather listen to Charles Manson's records than and they were probably recording them at the same time. I'd rather listen to Charlie Manson.
Glad you're here, good man. Glad you're here, Pat. I really am. No one wants to hear me and Mike agree about
there's
Good Vibrations is the best tune. Yeah, is that Good Vibrations? Is that like a saw? Woo!
I think it's the greatest summertime song
it's
ever.
It's up there. California Girls, the good songs.
And go figure, it was released in December.
I haven't found the great Beach Boys record outside Pet Sounds.
February.
Surf's Up, disappointing.
Right? The biggest thing for me in 66, I'm going to get this right out of the way, is John Lennon saying the Beatles are bigger than Jesus. That to me, that was just like, whoa.
Love it. Love it.
Well, the Beach Boys, getting back to the Beach Boys really quick, you know, the thing is, adding to what I was saying before, you have the three key albums that kind of change rock and set the tone for how rock would sound and how it would be presented in the future, largely attributed to the release of those three albums. And one of them is the Beach Boys' Pet Sounds. Controversial to a lot of people. The other one was Blonde on Blonde by Bob Dylan and the Beatles Revolver. 50th anniversary of all three albums. All three albums came out within 2 months of each other and they're three of the most influential albums of all time.
No record collection is complete without all three. And I think I read in 1966, what a wacky time.
My record collection is not complete.
You're not complete at all. That's funny, man. I think I read, if I'm not mistaken, that the number one and two song in the country at some month in 1966 was Bob Dylan, Rainy Day Women, Everybody Must Get Stoned. And that song, They're Coming to Take Me Away, ha-ha, They're Coming to Take Me Away, like that wacky shit, right? Those are the two crazy-ass tunes that are like on top of the charts at one time in 1966. Hard to wrap your mind around, man. Crazy.
Pet Sounds. But, thoughts on Pet Sounds. We know Pat's thoughts on Pet Sounds.
Yeah,
I want to ask Pat more questions about that when we're going to come around to Pat in a few minutes.
You know, I think it lives up to its gigantic stature. I listened to it again this week, and it's just an expression of pure ecstasy, honesty, emotional vulnerability, right? It's sweet. I mean, is it Brian Wilson talking about being faithful to one woman? He gets into that theme a couple times, how it's only you,
a lot of
baby.
Sadness in it,
right?
Too.
Sadness in it. God only knows is... maybe the greatest love song.
Sometimes I think it's like
the emotional vulnerability is just, it's just honest, right? And I need you. Well, it's hippie stuff, laying it on thick. I need you. You need me. We need each other. I love it. I'm
and there's
subscribed
a depressing
to it.
Element of it for me that just makes me wonder if it's the first breakup album. If it's Blood on the Tracks before Blood on the Tracks.
I'll take Maybe I'm Amazed. You know? It's the greatest love song ever written.
And I just said that for effect.
I think they have. I think the critics did a reassessment of Pet Sounds after the '80s because it didn't get a good response when it was released. You know, the, again,
it's flat out, it was weird. I just think I think it was weird.
There's weird things in it, man. That bridge, God only knows that bridge.
Yeah, structurally, I mean, the album opens up with
weird.
Wouldn't it be nice? And nothing happened. Everything in that song, there's no like, there's no verse. There's no, it's like verse, chorus. That's the structure, the typical structure of a pop song. Verse, chorus, guitar solo, or else bridge before the solo, and then it goes back into maybe a third verse, or just ride out the chorus to the end to fade out.
Right.
Okay. That broke all of that down.
Yeah.
The typical structure of a pop song did not exist on Pet Sounds. Wouldn't Zeppelin it be nice follow, if Zeppelin you follows, if you listen to that song? There's what you think is the verse, but there's no real chorus. Nothing goes around and comes back. And wouldn't it be nice? It's just this one idea followed by the next idea by the next idea. Then it slows down and the tempo totally changes.
There he is,
and then the song is over.
And he's subject wise talking to his girl. The more we talk about it, makes it so much harder to live it out. I just want to be with you, baby. It's you and I in ecstasy forever.
It might have been the first time that an album became a statement or a reflection of an artist's heart and mind, or, you know, his heart and soul, as opposed to just, you know, their mindset, which is what Dylan was doing. It was very heady and, you know, just the stream of conscious thought, what Dylan was doing. And, you know, the tortured artist, this reflection and statement that came out of an artist's soul, you know. And I think Pet Sounds was the first time that an album was used as an artistic statement that way.
It certainly impressed a lot of people.
I was looking. I've heard of The Guardian. I don't know what it is. I pulled a really good quote from it. It said, "The Pet Sounds is a cocktail party of mismatched guests." And just like people and things that just don't belong together, that just coexist and form this big operatic form of pop music that didn't exist before. And you know what? It wasn't until the reassessment, the critical reassessment of Pet Sounds didn't really come until the 80s, when Paul McCartney out of nowhere just kind of revealed that Pet Sounds was in fact...
He didn't reveal that till the 80s.
The inspiration behind, well, not I don't think I don't know about publicly now. If anybody can go back and find that quote, I really should have checked that out. But it was years later, like 20 years later, where like Paul McCartney came out and said, you know what, it was Pet Sounds that kind of inspired Sergeant Pepper. And those guys, it was a musical conversation. It was a dialogue going on in the 60s between the Beatles and the Stones. It was a conversation going on from album to album. There was a conversation between Rubber Soul and...
that conversation, a lot more artists involved than just the Beatles and the Stones, man.
Aftermath, you know? And then...
The Who, the Buffalo Springfield.
Clapton, you know, Clapton's autobiography, he said it best that, you know, that little area in England... Yeah, I mean, you had some of the heaviest hitters of all time in that one little area of music. I mean, the Beatles were making records already, but you had like the groundwork of the Beatles. I mean, the Stones, the Who, Led Zeppelin's, Cream, Jimi Hendrix was floating around. So there was like this giant pool of dust. It was just ready to bust, you know?
Yeah.
And it clapped. I highly recommend Clapton's autobiography, by the way. It's a really good read.
Man, I can imagine. Got to read that, man. And you know who was preternaturally talented, man? A real prodigy was Steve Winwood. They say little Stevie Winwood at like 17. Everybody wanted to sing
which
like
he closed
him,
his set with a few weeks ago.
Yeah,
everybody was dancing and shit.
What was he like, 13 when he was 16? 16? Was on that?
I think Stevie Wonder might have been younger than him. I'd have to look at that, try and research that a little bit. But he was, either way, he was a kid.
Yeah, yeah.
Prodigy, like you said, yeah, that was a great word.
According to what I read, I wasn't there.
So
I was listening.
One of my favorite stories is, you know, where Lennon and McCartney went to visit Brian Wilson in the studio. Now, Wilson was totally sweating Rubber Soul, and he had to put together, you know, he's got to do something big, and Lennon and McCartney kind of saw, he kind of got a firsthand view of what he was doing behind the scenes, and he was totally paranoid about having Lennon and McCartney in there, and McCartney and Lennon just walked out saying, Jesus Christ, what are we going to do? You know, we got to top this. This guy is like onto something.
Yeah, but he was paranoid to begin with, Wilson. I mean, he was like a very like a
yeah. He had there was the mental well kinda, there was the mental illness
he
and then
just
I
closed
think,
himself off to everybody and wrote music.
Plus, there was the psychedelics that he ingested. He was lucky he got off the way he did because you could have, you know, there's the Sid Barrett route too.
Yeah, and the Charlie Manson, the whole Charlie Manson route. How do you, you know, I mean, maybe he ends up, you know, dead. I mean, those people, you know, from what I had read, those people wouldn't leave his house. And he just, how do you ask that guy to leave?
Oh, you're talking about Dennis Wilson now.
Oh, Dennis, yeah, yeah.
That is a fact,
that thing
man.
With Charlie Manson.
Charlie Manson with his whole
Beach Boys
crew of freakazoids,
kind
of man.
You can't ignore that.
Approach Dennis Wilson. Dennis Wilson is scared to death that this fucking guy, whoever he is going to kill me, man. But instead, he gets down on his knees, kisses Dennis Wilson's feet. Long story short, Dennis Wilson has the whole Manson family living in his house, eating all his food, spreading their diseases. Yeah, Manson let him have full access to all his girls at any time, and he told him, whatever Dennis wants, you give to him. And Dennis loved that. But he found it became a problem,
yeah,
having
sure.
them living in your house. That's a little bit of a problem. Yeah, Charlie Manson's on my couch when I get up and when I come home.
How do you ask him to leave?
Yeah,
you
know, can you guys leave?
You guys got a scoot?
Yeah. Can you scoot?
I'm going out for bread. When I come back, y'all better not be here. Yeah, I had my Wilsons mixed up. Goes to show you how much I know about the Beach Boys.
How influential has it really been, though?
How influential has the Pet Sounds album been?
Yeah.
I always read about it in connection with Paul McCartney. He's always the big Pet Sounds groupie
that's
that we
real,
all read about over and over, man.
I hear about
everybody
too.
Loves the record, you know? Yeah.
So you think it might be a little overrated in that respect?
Might be a little overblown in that respect. But
Paul McCartney's rock royalty, though. And if he says he likes something, I mean, chances are it's probably going to be decent.
Yeah, it's probably decent, man.
I hear a lot of Pet Sounds in the Shins. That's about like the biggest...
The Shins.
Pet Sounds influence. Do you remember the
yes.
Shins?
Yes. Now that you mention it, I can hear that. Shins have one album that I like.
World, they put out, they must have about five or six albums by now, but I remember we were both really into the first album or two.
Yeah,
or three,
yeah, you're right.
And
we'll think after the show of all the albums.
My
that...
psychedelic party would be slightly different.
Even R.E.M. R.E.M. Oh. later on, when they got into the Up Reveal period, you hear a lot of Pet Sounds in those albums when they started getting with the electronic stuff.
Oh, there you go, bro. There's no doubt that R.E.M. Every time I listen to R.E.M., is it Up?
When Peter Buck put down the Rickenbacker and picked up all of the, they just got into the keyboard and synthesizer. And
it's Up, right? There's one R.E.M. album every time I listen
drum
to
machine
it. Pet Sounds,
period.
I think.
Yeah.
I think that's the one.
Yeah. There you go, bro. You answered the question for me. Yeah.
You know what? This is funny, boys. I got, like years ago, a colleague gave me, I showed you this a long time ago, Mike, this list of top 50 songs every year on a Billboard 100 chart from 1950 to 1999. It stops at 99, as it should.
That's a good thing
after
to have. I wish I had that.
1966. I looked this up. You know what the number two song in 1966
was? I think
was?
I might steal that from you.
You know what the... Yeah. It's,
wait,
it's
say it again. What is it?
You know what the number two song on a Billboard 100 of 1966 was?
Number two song. Let me guess, man.
I'll be blown away if you get it right.
Paint it black.
It's not guessable.
It's something like Frank Sinatra or Dean Martin or something like that.
Well, I was going to say...
Maybe...
Tom Jones?
You guys are all mentioning stars. I've never even heard of this person.
Wow.
No, the number two song in 1966 was The Ballad of the Green Berets by Sergeant Barry Sadler. And according to this thing, 1966, it makes no sense. If you go on YouTube, I looked it up. I listened to the song. All right, The Ballad of the Green Berets by Sergeant Barry Sadler. Everything you expect, right? He's standing there, you know, arms at his side, totally void of any emotion at all in his voice. Singing about the brave troops fighting for your freedom, everything you expect, regardless of the sentiment. It doesn't work as music. It's flat as a pancake and just a bad song. In the age of the Beatles and the Stones, this is the number two song in 1966. Look it up on your own. It's just crazy, man.
Two generations coexisting side by side on the pop charts, man. You know, that's hence my entire... you know, conversation.
Get
here.
Rid of the Hooters and start this show off with that song.
So everybody can hear what the hell I'm talking about.
Live Animals. You hear that? There's a threat to Live Animals now. What's it? What's the artist?
It's The Ballad of the Green Berets.
The Ballad of the Green Berets,
by Sergeant
man.
Barry Sadler.
All right.
I'm Casey Kasem.
Sergeant Barry.
Welcome to American Top 40. Our long distance dedication.
Time it come in from a slow song.
Gotta sing about a fucking dead dog.
Get Don on the phone. I can't tell you how many times I've heard that, and just it never gets old. Thank you, Howard Stern.
Yeah. So what do you want to talk? You want to talk about Revolver now or Bob Dylan? Talk about Revolver.
Flip
John
a coin.
Lennon.
Talk about John Lennon, man.
Hey, you know, the Beatles are bigger than Jesus Christ, man. Is that
they
what
they had to apologize for that a couple of months later? Had a
yeah,
press
they had burnings. It was yeah. Like it was like.
Let me say this.
Don't know.
Look at the change of the guard in time period here. When that happened, it caused the uproar that it did. Now you can walk around with a lip ring in your face and your eyebrow. It doesn't matter. You can say, "Oh, go F the Pope on a horse with a fucking sword." And nobody even bats an eyelash.
I think we have the counterculture to thank for that. I mean, the Summer of Love initially really did make a difference. Really did. They knocked down some doors.
The hippies
you
won.
You can laugh at the hippies all you want, man. The hippies won.
The hippies right. were right.
There's still people out there who get butt hurt, though, at every goddamn thing you say. And I'm sure they don't listen to me and be like, this guy's an asshole, but whatever.
But yeah. Now,
just the change, that's just amazing.
I think the whole foundation for our modern society that we live and take for granted today and don't really think about had its roots in the 1960s counterculture. Now, that's
thank
another
you, John
discussion.
Lennon.
That's a totally mm-hmm. different. It's inconsequential to what we're talking about. But I'm putting that thought out there.
I think we're bigger than Jesus Christ.
Anybody wants to talk about that? Message me on Facebook. Oof. Message me on our, email address rockunderfire@gmail.com. Is it .com? Is that what the email things are?
I think it's gmail.com.
Yeah, something like that. But yeah, you know, Revolver, man. Rubber Soul and Revolver are twins to me. Although, just the evolution that you hear between Rubber Soul and Revolver and then go from that to Sgt. Pepper.
It's totally natural.
Yeah.
Totally organic. I think Revolver is my second favorite Beatle record. I like the White Album, maybe, is my favorite record by the Beatles. Revolver is my second favorite. This is the time where we really go full-blown psychedelic. Tomorrow Never Knows, Love to You, to the chagrin of the more conservative Beatle fans who preferred they sing songs about taking your girl to the soda fountain. The old mop-top Beatles, it was a bad time for them because their favorite boys are changing in ways they don't understand or appreciate. And you got people like us, man, who that's where the Beatles really are really starting us, man. You know?
Yeah. Yeah, I think you and I, Mike, had that conversation. I like my Beatles stoned.
Yeah. Yeah. Like the trippy Beatles, man, all the way, man.
Yeah, I mean, for me, the Revolver, if I had to, I mean, you know, depending on the day you ask me, either the White Album or Revolver, it used to be Rubber Soul. Mm. When I first got into the Beatles, it was Rubber Soul was my favorite Beatles album for a very long time. But just seeing what they, you know, what they were doing, how far they went from Rubber Soul to Revolver. They're still twins. They're still like brother and sister albums to me. But I think now, I mean, Revolver, if I have to pick. But the thing is, you know, with Revolver, I would pick it over the White Album only because the Beatles were still writing together. By the White Album, they were writing for themselves.
But I don't think the music hurts for that.
Not at all. But it was a little bit more of
for that reason.
Yeah.
But
mine is still Sgt. Pepper. I just, you know, it's one of those. I can remember when I first got it on CD, and the vehicle I was driving and everything, and I just played it over and over and over and over and over. And just man, it just what an appreciation for that record.
Can't argue.
No argument there.
You can't. I mean, those three in a row. I mean, any band would want three records like that, three consecutive records like that, or just. That's your career.
Everything, exactly. And everything they turned out was that big or that good.
Yeah.
Every single one of them, you know, exception of, you know, maybe the very first album, Please Please Me, because it had a bunch of covers on it. Their sound wasn't as developed. You know, George Martin, man, you know, take him out of the equation. And we're gonna talk about him a lot during when we have our Beatles episode.
Yeah.
You know, what would the Beatles be without George Martin? You know, not maybe the Beatles, but what would those albums be without George Martin in the equation?
I think a lot of songs may never have even come into fruition without him, you know? Mm-hmm. I read something recently that suggested, all you need is love, were it not for George Martin, we probably wouldn't know it. he put the master stroke on that song in terms of whatever special effect he was using, overdubs or speeding up the sound. A genius for what he did. Well, you know, Revolver, and there's different pressings of it. I noticed. Me and my girlfriend were cooking the other night.
I always prefer the American version.
She has the American version. I put on her Revolver. I put on Revolver, honey. And we're cooking. And the album is done. And I didn't hear Dr. Robert. I didn't hear I'm Only Sleeping.
That's not the American version.
I didn't hear And Your Bird Can Sing. That's the best songs
out. Version, right?
Yeah. Now, I always like the UK version of with the Beatles, where the Americans, like in the States, they got Meet the Beatles.
Yeah.
Right.
But it came from With the Beatles. That With the Beatles is the better album, as far as I'm concerned. They have these, you know, UK releases and American releases. Same thing with Rubber Soul. The Rubber Soul that I got used to was the American version. So that opens up, not with Drive My Car, but it opens up with I've Just Seen a Face. And Drive My Car isn't even on it.
Mm.
And for years, that was the Rubber Soul I knew. And that's probably why it was my favorite album.
Yeah.
Because when I heard the real Rubber Soul years later, I was like, this changes it for me.
Yeah.
And, you know, just my taste toward what the Beatles were just kind of evolved, and I kind of saw that Revolver may have made the bigger impact.
Imagine, okay, you're in 66, you're in an up and coming band, you're ready to release a debut record. All of a sudden, this album Revolver comes out August 5th of 66, and now your record's not coming out till like November. You're like, holy shit, I gotta follow that. So, I mean, just for a second, if you look at that, because I actually have it, I pulled it up to see some other albums that were released in that year and month by month, actually. So August 5th, the Revolver came out. You had the Supremes, Jefferson Airplane, the Mamas and the Papas, James Brown, Nancy Sinatra. That's just August.
Yeah.
That's just August.
Wow.
Tom Jones, a compilation by Donovan, Dean Martin, who was still, you know, those guys were still hot, the lounge acts, Simon and Garfunkel, the Kinks. Elvis had a soundtrack for Spin Out. I mean, it's just some really wacky stuff. And I know it goes on, Smokey Robinson and the Miracles, another heavyweight. The Temptations even had a greatest hits record.
Yeah.
Cream, I think, was in there, too, later on in
the
year.
Oh, Cream must
right?
have been in there. Right?
Fresh Cream must was at the first.
Fresh Cream, yeah. Fresh Cream yeah. was in December of that year. I mean, so just a masterpiece like that comes out, and now you got to follow that? That just amazes me, and there were still some great records that came out after that, you know, by other bands. It just amazes me.
Yeah, I can't imagine even being in a band at that point. I'd have to be super confident in what. I'm going back to law school, ma. Something, anything. Like, I am not trying to compete with this. You notice this album, this right here, is one of the most underrated albums ever. 1966, the cover is iconic.
13th floor elevators.
It's called The Psychedelic Sounds of the 13th Floor Elevators, and it's the first time the word psychedelic was ever used in the history of music. This record is the key to some dark mystery, man. Amazing stuff. I plugged the 13th Floor Elevators very hard. Psychedelic Sounds, 1966. Check it out. It's on YouTube. Check it out. That's amazing good. Record. Amazing that's psychedelic.
You could
record.
Find that album in its entirety on YouTube.
That's a good plug.
Iconic cover. But what else is going on in 1966? Should we talk about
Blonde on Blonde?
The dude from Minnesota.
Hibbing.
Just bear with us, people. We got to talk about Bob for a couple minutes. Bear with us out there. I know what you're saying.
Well, Blonde on Blonde, where do we start with Blonde on Blonde?
Well, where do we start?
Can we
with
give
Blonde
a little backstory on Bob? Because Bob Dylan was this guy that came out of Hibbing, Minnesota, came out east to visit his hero Woody Guthrie in a hospital in New Jersey. Where in New Jersey was that? Is it
something State Hospital? What the hell was it? Yeah, it's on the tip of my tongue. Yeah.
And he quickly rose to the top of the folk. The whole folk world was just quickly dominated by Bob Dylan. He had entered the folk revival. It was this folk revival in the early 60s. And it was you had artists like Pete Seeger and who else was there? The Kingston Trio. But they were doing a lot of, it was a lot of, you know, We Shall Overcome and a lot of old
Kumbaya,
traditional,
traditional music.
And Bob came in with a lot of original topical songs, and he was putting it in a way that nobody had ever written before. And he had crossed over. He was like a crossover artist. I mean, even though the audiences were largely divided, you know, the college audiences were listening to folk music. They were going to the folk festivals, and Bob was their big artist. And the younger kids, it was all about pop music and rock and roll. So when Bob crossed over into, you know, and he strapped on an electric guitar at the Newport Folk Festival and came out with a rock band, you know, there's no overstating how shocking that was at the time. You have to put yourself, I guess, in the time period. And he, again, the Beatles were in awe of him. The Beatles revered him. And when he met the Beatles, that they said, well, that's where the Beatles kind of changed, when Bob, you know, influenced the Beatles and he influenced the Stones. He was basically pretty much influencing everything.
And Bob turned the Beatles onto pot.
And the rest is history.
The rest is history.
Yeah.
But when he comes out with Blonde on Blonde after, you know, Bringing It All Back Home, where it was the album where he went electric before Newport, but he put out an album that was half rock and half folk, half acoustic. And he was bringing, you know, hence Bringing It All Back Home, where he was bringing, the British invasion came around the same time. The Brits were bringing American music back to the States because America had got caught up in that bubblegum pop. Mm-hmm. And they lost their connection to the roots, to the founding fathers, and everything that was entailed in the music that inspired rock and roll. And the British bands were largely bringing American roots back to the States. And that's largely what the Stones were doing. And Bob comes out with Blonde on Blonde. And it's the first double album in rock and roll. One song, Sad Eyed Lady of the Lowlands, takes up an entire side. I mean, look, a year before, he had released Like a Rolling Stone. And it was a 6-minute pop song. That was unheard of. Nobody turns in a 6-minute pop song. Nobody's turning in a 4-minute pop song.
Bob changed the game. You had to have 3-minute songs about cars and girls. Now you got 6-minute songs about political issues, civil rights.
That's a great point.
Deeply introspective, intellectual songs. You really had to change. You had to become more inward-turning. Not only that, but he's kind of whiny-sounding, as a lot of you guys know. You don't have to properly sing anymore, thanks to Bob. We could talk about all that. But in 1966, he releases Blonde on Blonde, what is commonly known as his trio of electric masterpieces, along with Highway 61. I'm bringing it all back home, right? And that was Blonde on Blonde, the apex of his great artistic period. You know, sometimes artists, a lot of them have periods of great brilliance, right? Where their artistry is in full flower. I'm reading about Prince, right? Prince had, in a 2-year period, 13 songs that he wrote cracked the top 20, Billboard top 20. Not all of them are songs that he sang. I mean, Sheila E., the Bangles are singing, but Prince had this white-hot period of creative brilliance, 13 songs he writes in the top 20. That is the case with Bob Dylan, I think, through 1965. White-hot brilliant. There's nothing he couldn't achieve. Just magnificent before he ultimately crashed and burned for a little while. And the songs are beyond description. I mean, like, what is Blonde on Blonde? Is it blues? Is it rock and roll? He's searching for that. What did he call it? That white electric sound, right?
It's mercurial sound or
mercury sound? Mercury that wild sound, mercury
that wild
sound.
Wild mercury sound.
That's it. It's wild mercury music.
I mean, if you listen to Visions of Johanna, it's unprecedented. There's nothing before that sounds like that in rock and roll. Yeah. On the surface, it's very basic. It's just a couple of chords. There's nothing spectacular about, you know, on the surface, the beat or anything. It's very Or, you know, it's not unorthodox by any means, but the sound of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Let's not forget the infamous backing band on that record was, of course, the Hawks.
Yeah.
Who later on became an influential band in all in their goddamn right, man.
Yeah.
Love the band.
And like, oh, my.
Like Stick said, he crashed and burned. And for anybody that's interested in this period of Bob Dylan, and, you know, we know a lot of Bob Dylan haters. And, again, he's, you know, we get a lot of, we respect Bob, but we can't stand him.
I'm
not
a hater, and it's not that I can't stand him, because he's written some of the most influential music.
If there's anybody genuinely interested in this period and what happens,
I thank him for the band, though,
to Bob Dylan, is to look into Martin Scorsese's No Direction Home. And go to the very end of it, the very last scene where you see what happens to Bob and the effect that of how just being, you know, having these labels stamped on him, the spokesperson of a generation and the Pope of this and the general of that and the president of, and not wanting to be on the road, and the effect that the drugs were having on him, and just he needed to bail. He wanted no part of it anymore, and you just see him, and he's just, you know, he's getting death threats, and somebody threatens to shoot him on stage that night, and he says, you know, I don't want to go to Italy, I don't want to go to Rome, I just want to go home, man.
Sucks.
I just want to go home, yeah. And the movie ends like that. And you know, about a month later, Bob has, you know, a quote unquote motorcycle accident. It's a disappearance that kind of leads to this cult of Bob Dylan, this mystery, this growing mystery that continues, you know, is continued over the decades up till now. Did it really happen? What really happened on that road in New York State this week, 50 years ago, late July in 1966? And to this day, it's just the most speculated upon story in at least the mythology of rock and roll.
With the passing time, too, ideas that the motorcycle accident didn't even happen or was barely an accident at all.
Some people say it never happened.
Getting more credence. Like,
he
just fell off the bike.
It really did. It was just his way of
walking the bike. And he got a paper cut and dropped out. You know,
yeah. And he dropped out for a long time. And there were albums in between, but, you know, he cut his hair off, grew a beard, became, you know, started turning out country music. And then he, you know, and it was just the beginning of one change after another. And that was the beginning of the artist, like the chameleon artist. And it kind of made it okay for artists like David Bowie and Prince and Madonna. And maybe Lady Gaga now is one of those artists that are going to be the chameleon artist, where they go through periods, mm-hmm, and they change and they piss off their fans every 5 years.
Yeah.
You know, just come out of left field. Okay, it's the start of another period. Beck is another one of those artists. Elvis,
sure,
Costello,
sure.
Who else?
Bruce.
That, you know, hey, I was, getting back to the Bruce thing too, because that label thing is a tough thing. That's a tough thing to have.
Yeah.
The voice of a generation. You know, and a decade later, you just said Bruce was labeled that. You know what I mean? And Bruce didn't want to carry all that weight. I mean, he didn't turn into a recluse, as, you know, like Dylan did. He didn't kind of, you know,
the first label that was hung on Springsteen was that he was the new Dylan.
Yeah. And that, you know, that Time and Newsweek magazine coinciding with each other. I mean, that's got to be a lot of weight to hold, man. A lot of pressure on you. So you can see why these guys sometimes turn inward and just say, I don't want to do this,
man.
And it's very easy. I've been on vacations where I've just been like, I just want to go home. It happens. So, I mean, that guy had the weight of the world on his shoulders. And he's just like, I don't want to go to Italy. I want to go home.
Yeah.
Very easy to understand that.
I don't want to belabor the point about Bob. I heard something very, very interesting recently, man. Who's the great documentary filmmaker whose name I can never remember? Does all the great documentaries.
Burns.
Rick Burns and Ken Burns.
Yeah,
Ken Burns
did Jazz, right?
Ken Burns did, yeah.
Watching Jazz. I never saw the baseball one. I'm watching Jazz, and I think Wynton Marsalis comes on, and he says, great art is not going to come to you. You have to come to it, right? You have to make the effort. You have to go to it, right? And that was true for me with Bob, you know? Like, you're not just going to look at a Picasso painting or a Jackson Pollock and understand and appreciate it. You probably hate it. But you got to, oh, why does everybody like this? You know, why is this so regarded? You know, you got to start to ask questions, maybe read a book or two. You got to go to it. And you got to go to, if you're going to listen to Blonde on Blonde, you got to go to him. You got to put the record on. Open up your mind to this sour-sounding harmonica and voice and allow the transformation to come. You have to go to Bob. Bob's not going to you. Bob doesn't give a shit about you. Fuck about you.
Bob wants your money.
He doesn't care. He wants your money.
That's all Bob.
It's like Keith Richards called him the prophet of profit.
Prophet.
He's playing soon too, and it says show starts 7:30 sharp. You never see that on a ticket stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
7:30 sharp.
Oh yeah. What, Bob?
It says it right there. Yeah, Bob.
Yeah.
He's playing Coney Island or something. He's playing somewhere in Brooklyn. Yeah. 7:30 sharp.
I may or may not go to that.
Axl Rose should take a little note on that one, huh?
Yeah.
7:30 sharp.
But listen, with respect to Blonde on Blonde as the first double album, we can't talk double albums without mentioning Frank Zappa, because just a few weeks to a month later, Frank Zappa puts out his first album, I believe. Was it his first album?
His first record
Freak
was
out.
Double record,
Freak
yeah.
Out. Freak Out. And,
oh, what a mad
that's right,
genius,
that's 1966.
Man. What a mad genius. I didn't mean to cut you off.
No,
Mike.
I'm putting it out there, and
genius.
You know, you do with it what you will.
You gotta love the guy. You know,
yeah,
he was. I hate to say this because I'm gonna get killed for this one. He was Steely Dan before Steely Dan. Steely Dan doesn't give a shit about what they're singing about. They could care less. The movie, the song Everyone's Gone to the Movies
yeah.
is the probably worst lyrically song I've ever heard in my life. And Zappa was that. Zappa could
yeah.
care less.
Yeah.
Zappa just. Come on, I mean, his later stuff like Joe's Garage
yeah.
and shit like that, you know, the later stuff and Chic Your Booty, he didn't care. The musicians were just so great.
Yeah, it just goes to show the lyrics don't have to be great.
No, and
yeah.
you could look up old YouTube stuff of him and that band that he had. Every single little noise, he knew what was coming and where it was coming from and why it was going.
Yeah, oh yeah.
And he couldn't read a lick of music.
No.
No, could not. Later on, Steve Vai got his start with him, actually.
That's right.
Transcribing, he was going to, the school in New York.
Juilliard.
Yeah, and I guess was transcribing some of Frank's music and sent it to him. And Frank sent them back. He goes, transcribe this. And then, like, eventually he flew out to California.
You're hired.
And
yeah.
There's a really good video of them two.
You can stay.
Yeah, yeah. A really good video of those two trading licks, too. Steve Vai and Frank Zappa. Something you wouldn't see every day, man.
Wow. What killed Frank Zappa again?
It was cancer, wasn't it?
Was
did
it
he cancer?
Yeah, he died of cancer
in
1993.
Yeah, and he was big on the, you know, against the PMRC and you know, him and Dee Snider,
yeah.
you know, taking their seats against
what a loss,
man. It was. It really was. He was all about, you know, the music, and he was a really cool dude, man. And, you know, I mean, obviously he's in the news again recently because his son, Dweezil, was doing, like, Zappa on Zappa, and, I guess the family, you know, he's in a big fight with his brother Ahmed, actually. The family owns, like, the legacy or the whatever it is. I'm not a lawyer. I don't know what it's called.
Yeah.
But they kind of were trying to stop Dweezil from calling it Zappa on Zappa and a whole big stupid
right,
legal thing.
Right.
I posted an article. I think it might have posted
it. I was thinking, that sounds familiar. And one of us, I think it was you that posted that.
Yeah, it's a shame to see that because, you know, Frank wouldn't have wanted that. Frank would have wanted his kids out there playing his music.
Yeah.
Frank could care less.
It really was all about the music. And, you know, even Freak Out is kind of, I spent some time with it. And it's, you know, it's more derivative than innovative, if anything. But, you know, all first and second albums are derivative of something.
Right.
You know, so it's steeped in R&B and doo-wop. You know, aside from if it's groundbreaking in any way, it's just for the fact that it existed.
It was a double record.
It was a double record. It was just the satirical avant-garde nature of it is groundbreaking. Arguably, there were bands like the Fugs and the Monks, which are kind of very, if they're on the radar at all, that was doing that satirical
right.
thing. But you cannot have a discussion about 1966 without bringing out Freak Out and Frank Zappa,
yeah.
because that was also the beginning of his career.
Who have we forgotten? Rolling Stones do Between the Buttons in 1966.
You had Aftermath.
Aftermath.
And, you know, Mother's Little Helper, and just, you know, they were still kind of like a really good singles band. The Stones
right.
hadn't really
Painted Black around that era.
Painted Black and Lady Jane.
I don't hate the Stones that much, guys.
maybe not. Maybe 19th Nervous Breakdown. Although I don't know. I don't believe it was on Aftermath.
Singles.
I wish I had a copy of Aftermath in front of me.
EPs and singles.
It's over there,
then,
under my thumb.
When I was looking into when I was researching 66, some of the stuff I was pulling on wiki pages and stuff like that. EPs and singles. Like, you know, there was like some, even some Beatles stuff. It was like an EP of like two or three songs.
Yeah.
I guess I don't know if it was like a, hey, this is what we're working on, check this out, you know,
yeah,
something like that. I mean, obviously, Yellow Submarine was like the big one. Everybody was like, "Oh my god,
yeah,
what the hell is this?" Remember that? Remember the cartoon for that when we were kids?
Yeah.
Oh man, how trippy that was.
I'm like debating admitting whether or not I should admit that I've never seen the cartoon.
Really?
That's why. That's why I'm sitting here just staring down.
Oh yeah, no. Honestly, I haven't seen it since I was like a kid, dude.
Yeah,
like,
I haven't watched it
recently. I have like really no memory of what went on in it at all. Yeah, you know?
It was, I mean, we're children of the 70s. It was, you know, I haven't seen it recently.
Yeah, missed that one.
We touched on some really cool things in 66, man. I even learned a few things here.
All right.
I'm stubborn like a rock.
Is it the year that we can pinpoint that, you know, the marker for the significant change in music? Or is it, you know, I think by the time 67?
And the question is, did Dylan drive that? Because you guys brought up some good points about Dylan, and I kind of just sat back and shut my mouth and listened to what you had to say about it. I will go out and listen to that record now. I absolutely will.
Dylan wasn't really doing much experimentation in the studio, so I think even if Dylan, it didn't matter what Dylan did in 1966. You know, there still would have been Pet Sounds and Revolver, and you know, Rubber Soul before that. Although Rubber Soul was at the tail end of 65, but all of this stuff was happening simultaneously.
After the fact, though, I'm talking like 66 or 67 and 68, 69. I mean, did he have that much of an influence over what
was
to come?
He was the avatar, man. He was the, you know, the jester that Don McLean speaks about, man, in American.
A lot of them would say so, man. Jimi Hendrix would say so, and David Bowie would say so. They both wrote and covered his songs, and wrote
songs. It was no accident or coincidence that people were writing and speaking directly to Bob through their music in the late 60s and early 70s. You know, Song to Bob Dylan by David Bowie.
I think Bob, in the image of Bob we get from 1966, that classic image of his wild hair and the black sunglasses, he takes the sunglasses off and those crazy speed freak eyes and the wild abandon of his every movement, the freedom. He was everything John Lennon wanted to be.
And if you go back to
John really looked at Bob like, damn, you know, like, that's where I'm going. And he did.
Even if you go back to his acoustic folk period, it was, you know, he kind of foresaw what was happening. The times, they are changing, man. Get out of the new, you know, get out of the new road, man. If you can't lend a hand, the times they are changing. A hard rain's going to fall. You know, he saw the whole thing going down. And then when it finally went down, he bailed. He packed up and split, and he didn't want any part of it. And he turned out, you know, he's turning out Nashville Skyline. And I think the most cryptic Bob Dylan album, and sometimes I think it's getting off topic a little bit, but keeping it to Dylan, the most cryptic, mysterious, and sometimes I think his consistently best album beginning to end is John Wesley Harding. The album, the first thing he did after being gone for like a year and a half. Now, a year and a half in 1966, 67 was an eternity because artists were putting out three albums a year.
Yep.
So if you had to wait a year and a half for an album, that
felt
was
like forever, which is ridiculous by today's standards.
Yeah, it really is.
But John Wesley Harding is a very accessible Dylan album.
And you have the Drifter's Escape, which is a lot of...
if you're curious about Bob, that's a good
suggestion. The Dylanologists
attribute
it to his saying, you know what, a bolt of lightning struck the courthouse out of shape, and just then the Drifter did escape.
It's about him.
You know, and that's the motorcycle accident.
Yeah. Yeah, but John Wesley Harding, if you're curious about Bob, put that one on. You like that record. You like
one
that
day
record.
We'll do a show on the motorcycle accident.
Just motorcycle accidents
just
in general.
Talk about motorcycle accidents in general.
Yeah, it doesn't have to only be his. Motorcycles have taken some people, man.
I feel
unless
sorry for Pat. We've
Bono
been talking about
ski into a tree.
Bob. Talking about Bob and the Beach Boys for an hour. Poor Pat, man. We need more. Next show is going to be a more Pat-friendly show.
I will have
man.
My day.
Yeah, Pat, you tell us what you want us to talk about next show. You
it's
tell
good,
us,
man.
Babe.
I got my word in edgewise. I said, especially about the Beach Boys, I said what I needed to say about those guys.
For what it's worth, Mike said he wants to get away from list-type shows, but in the near future, we have to have 5 overrated, 5 underrated. And
that's
great,
in there, yeah.
And the greatest singers, greatest pure singers, top Ooh. 5 whatever, greatest pure singers. These are things
now, what are
I want to play with.
Let's do that more like, let's do that sooner rather than later. Let's do that show coming up
with
soon.
The singers or the top 5
overrated and underrated acts?
Overrated and underrated. Acts or records?
Artists and
bands. Or singers.
Artists and bands.
And
or singers. Okay.
Overrated and underrated.
In fact, let's put that out there for our listeners out there that are listening to this. If you're still listening.
Please.
Go to our Facebook page and just give us your, we'll probably put a post out there. Give us your choices for top 5 underrated and overrated bands or artists.
Do we have a time frame that these should be? I mean, from the 50s to current?
Anything.
That's generally how we keep it.
Anything, yeah. Keep just the whole seven-decade stretch of rock and roll.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, this is good. I'm going to take some fucking heat for this one, boys.
Woo! Go nuts, man.
Stoke the
and
fucking
maybe,
fire.
You know, we'll do this show in a couple weeks. Maybe it'll even be our next one. Who knows?
Stir the pot. Yeah, you know, it occurs to me, Rock Under Fire, who did we put under fire tonight? Did we criticize anyone?
Oh, he put the Beach Boys under fire, man.
What do you want to say? Say something bad about the Beach Boys so we could put them
I got to break Brian Johnson out, man.
I'll burn them on the beach, right in the big bonfire.
Now, Brian Johnson's not working these days, so we're hiring him, man. Yeah. Brian Johnson's
Johnson,
on our podcast. Come on out, Brian.
There you go, Mike Love. You're under fire, you big jerk face. Take that.
We'll see you guys next time, man.
Peace.
Peace out, guys. Bad news, but only if you're out of it. Bad news, but only if you want to be. You can lose. Pouring on me, bad news keep pouring on me.